A very special guest with us who is known for his entrepreneurial grit, foresight, and strategy. He's the founder of BizTalk Server, SharePoint Server, and Kaizala at Microsoft. So I take the privilege to welcome Rajiv Kumar, Corporate Vice President of Microsoft, to our show, HarshiTalk, Drones to Dronas. Thank you so much, Rajiv, for being with us on HarshiTalk. So, Rajiv, we know you for your leadership, and we know you have been very instrumental in some of the key development and implementations at Microsoft. But today we would like to start knowing you more as a person, the gist of your family, and where did actually Rajiv come from?
Okay, so I'm Rajiv Kumar. I was born in a very small village in Jharkhand. I did my schooling in Calcutta St. Xavier's, so it was just a serendipity I ended up in Calcutta St. Xavier's. From St. Xavier's, I went to IIT Roorkee.
Okay.
And that's where I did my bachelor's in computer science. From there, I went to Austin, Texas for my PhD program. And from there, I was a campus hire in Microsoft. So this is the only company I've ever worked. I worked about 12 to 13 years in US, and then the last 12, 13 years here. So I have half and half experience in both the countries.
Okay.
That's where I come from.
Okay. And just about your family?
Okay. So I have, I'm married with two beautiful daughters.
Wonderful.
I just feel very fortunate to have two daughters. I could not trade for anything else. So, and they both are in college right now. One of them is doing medical in Christian Medical College, CMC. One graduated from IIIT Hyderabad.
Wow.
And got a job in US Microsoft, so she's gone to US.
Wow, great. So having said that, shuttling between office and your travel and your family, I also know that you are passionate about cycling and yoga and meditation. How do you manage time between your work and your passion and your family?
Right. See, it comes down to what you believe in life. What do you want to achieve in life? And I think what I've realized is the key to be successful and happy in life is to be balanced and centered.
Right.
And when I say balance, it really means when you're young, if you ask a young person, or even me when I was young, they would say money and job. But really you need few things to be successful in life, or you can say in the end, I had a beautiful life. And I think the five things I care about is health, spirituality, that's why I got into meditation. Family, friends are important. Job and colleagues and helping others is important. And finally is maybe enough money to be happy. So really, I try to balance all five. So that way, meditation helps me get to my spirituality, achieve that goal, that path to know God, to experience God. Cycling and yoga helps me to be healthy. So I think that's why. So if you actually just want to do exercise, it won't work. You really have to have a framework of what you want to from this life. And if you have the right framework, then you'll find time. People say, how do you find time? I said, I don't know. I just find time because I just do it.
You want to do it.
Yeah, I want to do it. Exactly. You're right. Yeah.
That's so beautifully articulated, Rajiv. So to be able to manage time, again, coming back to the question, how does your typical day at work be like?
Right. Yeah, well, I get up around 6:30 to 7. And so I've blocked 7 to 9 for meditation, yoga. First yoga, then meditation, have breakfast and come to office. So I come to office around 9:30, 10.
Okay.
Then I'm here till 6. Again, I have blocked from 7 to 9, cycling and meditation. Then I have my dinner at 9. Then I'm back at work around 9:30 to maybe 11:30, 12, and then I sleep at 12. So that's my typical day, actually. I'm very, very disciplined that way.
Wonderful to know that. I mean, to be able to manage on spot, on dot, to be able to manage throughout the day, it's really...
It might shift a little bit. See, you have to be flexible. It will not always work that, but the sequence is important. You have to know what you want to do.
Right.
Otherwise, I'll get up and just have tea and read newspaper and I'm done. Versus if you know, hey, I need to do my meditation and yoga first, then read newspaper, and I think that has worked out.
And I'm sure it took a lot of effort to do what you're doing right now.
Yeah, and actually, to be honest, India helps me with that. And that's one of the reasons I came back to India, is because I can live a more balanced life. US is awesome too, by the way. US has a lot of benefits, very clean, very safe, very easy to drive, no traffic. But India gives the freedom because you have so much help around. So.
True, very true. So what were some of the early challenges in your career that you felt shaped your thinking and approach towards leadership and the kind of leader that you are right now?
Yeah. So I think that's a very good question. I was a geek. I used to write code, and it did not help that both me and my wife are computer science engineers. So we both used to write code, and we had no life for almost 10 years. And that was fine. We really loved it because I worked on Visual Basic, Excel, initial years. So I have a lot of impact, and that was fun. But then I realized like I was just one-sided, just code and work. I wanted to balance my life, and that was the inside thing. And so I ended up being a manager at that time, and I did not even know what a leader is, right? And I was trying to be a manager. It was a very difficult transition for me, because of multiple things. Once I was a geek, so I really had to work on presence, learning how to interact with people, how do you put eye to eye and talk, the way you dress up, the way you stand, the way you use your hands, everything matters to project a professional person. There was a time when people said, you have no presence. I would say something, people would not listen. And from that to I think Microsoft is an awesome company because Microsoft really invested in me, believed in me, spent maybe $250,000 on me to fix me up, because I had like 3 or 4 coaches. One to how to interact, how to speak clearly, how to speak in a big forum, how to dress up, how to sit, everything was taught. So it is a acquired skill.
That's, unless you tell us, I don't think anybody would believe that when we see Rajiv now.
Yes. And a lot of people say, oh, dress doesn't matter. Everything matters.
It matters.
Because everything conveys who you are. Yes. You have to realize that. And me as a geek, like just doing computer science from a village, and I did well probably because I got a fellowship, for example, in US. And so I was very much into just code and intellectual. But life is much more than just being an intellectual person. You have to be a leader. And that leadership transformation, I think Satya influenced a lot on me, because I worked for him for 5 years, right around when I was struggling with my personal philosophies, personal values, and professional values. And that is another story of values.
Satya is a great leader, as we see from his interviews and how he projects he conducts it, right? So speaking of the CEO, Satya, you had a chance to work with all 3 CEOs who happen to be great leaders also. And I'm sure you would have learned your way out. Yeah. So what is your leadership style?
It's hard to put leadership style in few words, but if I had to pick 1 or 2 words, it will be transformational or purposeful leadership, actually. And or inspirational is the better word, because the kind of people we work with, the kind of people we hire, they're all from IITs. They're all like less than 100 JE rank. You can't tell them what to do. What you can only do is inspire them to do something great, actually. So I think my main job is really as a coach to inspire them with a purpose that they will give 120% of their life, actually. Wow. That is transformational leadership in my mind.
That's very interesting. And in fact, I can see how motivational that would be for teams who is working with you already.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes. So, given the demand of cross-skilling across multiple industries, right? So what would be your suggestion of proportionate between technical and management skills for people who are aiming at leadership roles?
Again, very good question. I'll say, look, what do I value as a leader among my leaders? How do I evaluate myself? I think there are 3 aspects, I would say. One is creating clarity.
Yes.
Because as a leader, you have to create clarity for the organization, for your leaders, so that they know what they need to achieve. That's super important. You can have a great vision, but you don't have the clarity how to get there, I think then it's like not useful. So clarity is very important.
Right.
Second thing I look at is, can the leader generate energy? And energy is really, it's not about just building a team and hiring people, but can you generate energy so they work as a team? They work with each other. They have a growth mindset. They listen. So listening is important. Yes. Having diversity in the leadership in your team is important, because if everybody is the same, then it will only do so much. But if everybody is different, you can achieve more because there will be more ideas. So second is generating energy. And third is execution excellence or delivering success are the two things. So, and that is about being very methodical and disciplined about how do you go about achieving that. So one is about what to do, which is the clarity, who, generating energy, those are the people who will go make it happen. And the third is how, is to execution. So those are the three.
That is amazing, actually. Again, I'm sure I'm using a lot of amazing, because I'm myself inspired as we speak. So talking about your baby, the Kaizala,
yes.
I have seen how instrumental you have been in implementing it with the public sector as well, right?
Yeah.
So how do you see Kaizala or Microsoft contributing towards smart city evolution in India? Because that's where we are looking at new, more futuristic ideas for smart city development, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Your thoughts on that?
Yeah. So Kaizala is an amazing product from this part of the world, which can help companies get their work done on a simple chat interface.
Okay.
Let me just give you a little bit of background. See, when I came to India, my vision was to build a world-class team that can change the world. I think after 15 or 14 years, I think we are there.
Yes.
It has taken me that long to build the team. The Kaizala is a product that is designed for working in emerging markets. See, developed markets like US and Europe is a very desktop and browser market. What Kaizala is designed to get work done. And smart cities concept is really about empowering the city leaders to stay ahead of the curve, to solve problems, to discuss stuff, be connected with citizens so that you can actually interact with citizens and get things done. I think Kaizala is an amazing platform for government to connect with citizens. And Andhra Pradesh government is a living example of that, where Chandrababu Naidu is connected with almost 250,000 or more people, where he hears back on comments from the citizen for any initiative he does. And that probably is the true or epitomizes what a smart city or a smart government would do, is real-time governance. And that's what Andhra Pradesh government is doing using Kaizala as a platform.
Yes, I think that's again a wonderful job that government is doing in alignment with you guys.
Right. They get almost 30, 40, 50,000 feedback every week.
Wow.
That is amazing amount of data to listen to and be able to do the right thing, what is required for the place, not just make up something that you think is important. So it is transformational government.
True, very true. So speaking about emerging markets and the world revolving around apps, right? So how do you foresee the apps, relevancy of apps in the era of AI and machine learning evolving to become a single point of service?
Yeah. Very, very good question. See, apps was the panacea for every problem in the last 10 years, right? Because people say, oh, you don't need this, you can just build an app and put it on the store. So we ended up with almost like 400 to 500 million apps. Now, if you ask any person, like ask yourself today, how many apps do you use? Maybe 10.
Right.
Like very few use 15. So what happens to the other half a billion minus 15 apps? I think it's become a graveyard actually of apps. Because people are tired, there's an app fatigue, and that's real. App fatigue is real. So that's why if you look at some of the most developed in terms of emerging market and mobile usage, is China. In fact, Kaizala is aspiring to be the super app for the rest of the world, because you can build these cards, which are really small apps that just comes and goes. You don't even notice it, depending on which group you're talking to or who you're connecting with. Like Andhra Pradesh government has 5 or 6 apps in Kaizala, but you don't know their apps, but they're simple apps. So the app fatigue is real. So I think there has to be a solution. There are going to be, what will evolve is these super apps where you can just build apps, and AI and machine learning will be transformational, because in the group there's so much learning. Like there's a group of people, all the salespeople, for example, talking. There's a lot of knowledge being developed, but nobody captures it. But using machine learning in Kaizala, we are actually creating a bot that learns as it goes. For example, the same question gets asked every month. Now nobody has to answer because the bot knows the answer. Because right. somebody else answered 3 months back, 2 months back, so the bot learned it now. And that is transformation. So things will get simpler moving forward. It is quite complicated now.
I'm sure it would. So one last question for you, Rajiv, is what are the adjacent industries that took long enough time to be benefited by the innovations that Microsoft has been doing so far? Say, for example, farming industry. So what are the other industries that you're looking at, in contributing with innovation technology at all in India?
So I think the two industries that I feel can be transformed completely is healthcare and agriculture. Okay. They are the last bastions because I'm working very closely with Dr. Sethi, for example, Dr. Devi Sethi, who runs yes. NH Narayana Hisdale, and he tells me, like army, the highest paid industry or spend industry is healthcare. In spite of $8 trillion being spent on healthcare, only about 9 to 10% of this planet people have healthcare access with dignity. We believe we can transform healthcare so that with the same amount of money, we can reach 25%, 20-25%, double it actually. Wow. Because it's very inefficient, and that's why we are working with Narayana Hidayare to create, for example, a EMR or electronic medical record, which normally takes billions of dollars for a hospital to create and put in the back end, in a very distributed, lightweight way in Kaizala, so that the cost of that is like at the bottom or no cost.
Okay.
And each patient can their own have their medical record in their phone in a secure space on the cloud that they own, nobody else can get to, and they can share whatever they need to share with the doctor, which is very different than the traditional way of doing EMR.
Yes.
So I think healthcare is like right there. Agriculture is the other one because we need to be able to connect with all the farmers. We are working with many companies in India. I can't name them. I'm not sure I can name them, who are aspiring to connect with 4 to 6 million farmers across India and Asia using Kaizala, because Kaizala is designed to work in these remote locations and still work even if you don't have internet. But when you connect with internet, the data gets synced up whenever, right? And I think so we are working with at least 3-4 big companies in India and in Asia to transform agriculture. Because think about like pricing or availability. Today it is very ad hoc.
Correct.
Farmers have to travel 3 hours to get to the mandi where they can tell how much they have.
Correct.
And what the price, and now they are there, they can be misused, because by evening if you have not sold, you will want to sell at lower price and go back home, or next day they go back home. But with Kaizala, all that can be done no matter how remote you are, and that will empower farmers, I think. So these two are very transformational.
Wow, that is very interesting to know, actually.
Yeah. And we are working in both industries right now
to
transform this.
Super, super. That's great. Nice. So thank you so much, Rajiv, for your time to be on our show, HarshiTalk. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. So that was Rajiv for us. I hope it was a very motivational bite from a very prominent leader. We will come back to you again with stories from more prominent leaders in the next episodes. Thank you.